Hello, my name is Anfinn Norbø, and on behalf of the Norwegian-Ukrainian Chamber of Commerce, I would like to welcome you all here to the Litteraturhuset. The Norwegian-Ukrainian Chamber of Commerce is a non-profit NGO working for increasing trade and bilateral relations between Norway and Ukraine, and we also work to support economic and democratic development in Ukraine. And we are very pleased to have you here and our three important guests here. I have to say that unfortunately the Foreign Minister Børge Brende had to cancel his participation, but we are very lucky to have the Minister of European Affairs, Mr. Vidar Helgesen, instead. So we are very grateful for that. So now we'll give the floor to Hans-Willem Steinfeld. And have a nice evening.
Thank you very much. Since the topic is the Ukraine, I'd like to meet you and greet you, and last but not least, greet our distinguished guests by saying by Anton Chekhov, they had a good seminar today prior to this meeting, so we may say that we embark upon this discussion on the crisis of values on the axis east-west through Chekhov's words, smile through tears. Give a good welcome to Bernard Henri Lévy and Minister of European Affairs, Vidar Helgesen. Welcome to the House of Literature, Mr. Lévy. You are a revered European, and if I may repeat the highlights of the Cold War, all made in Russia, then I would say the first peak was the Berlin blockade, then it was the crushing of the Berlin uprising in 53. Then it was the invasion of Hungary in 56, Czechoslovakia 68, imposed forcefully martial law in Poland in December 81. In this perspective, how would you kind of place Russia's behavior versus the Ukraine last year?
We have to listen to what Putin himself says. He expresses it very clearly. He positions himself in the continuity of the history you just summarized. He affiliates himself to Pierre Le Grand on one side, to Stalin on the second side, and he uses to say that the biggest catastrophe of the 20th century is not the Holocaust, not the First World War, not the Second World War in general, but the collapse of Soviet Union. So Vladimir Putin is doing what he can to reconnect Russia with this infamous past. The thing I would like to add, because this is not very surprising at the end of the day, what is more surprising is that the reaction of the West in front of that seems to me rather often to be also similar to the reaction of the same West at the time of Budapest, East Berlin, Prague, and so on, which is non-appeasement, which is replying to force by dialogue, which is replying to imperialism by doing, like a French minister of foreign affairs said, I'm sorry, he was French, of course we will do nothing. This was Mr. Chesson at the time of the martial law in Poland. So Putin is the inheritors of the Russian tyrants of this time, and often, not always, the West inherits also of the paradigm of this time.
Vidar Helgesen, you're Minister of European Affairs. is it relevant to consider Ukraine's struggle now as the last decolonialization attempt?
I'm not sure it's the last. And,
but it is a decolonialization.
And I'm not sure I would use the label decolonialization. But I would like to emphasize that it is an extremely important test case for Europe. As we know, European integration is at the heart of the situation in Ukraine. But Ukraine is also at the heart of European integration now. The credibility of the European continued European integration project now rests very much on Ukraine. And you can add to that Moldova, Georgia, countries that have signaled that they want to Europeanize and that are met with strong responses from Russia to that aspiration. And therefore, it's very important that Europe acts in a firm way. And I would slightly disagree that the choice from the West here or from Europe here is appeasement, because the sanctions imposed were, to many, actually quite a surprisingly strong European statement, and the ability of European countries to galvanize and unite around sanctions was probably more than many would have expected at the outset of the crisis.
May it influence the matter that Poland did a tremendous success as a member of the European Union from 2004 and tripled their gross national product? What if the Ukraine had only weakly copied Poland? Would that have put Russia in an awkward position in their sphere of influence, like they used to call it?
Well, first of all, you're pointing to an important fact, which is that at the time of the breakup of the Soviet Union, Ukraine and Poland had a similar size of their GDPs. Since then, Poland's has grown into, I think now it's 3 or 4 times bigger than Ukraine's. Now, if a Ukrainian success would be Russia's failure, well, I think that is at the heart of the problem, because the perception of Mr. Putin seems to be that this is a zero-sum game. I'm convinced that a successful Ukraine would be better for Russian economy and better for Russian stability, and that European integration for Ukraine is not bad for Russia. That is not the view from Moscow.
Mr. Levy, in 68, we got the Brezhnev Doctrine. The Soviet Union had the right to march into Czechoslovakia to defend her interests. Is the invasion of the Crimea a repetition or restoration of the Brezhnev Doctrine?
Of course, yes. And that's why I say that the paradigm has not so much changed. Of course, sanctions. But Crimea is in Russia today. There was fake elections, fake watchers of these elections, and I did not hear any protest recent in the big chancellery of Europe saying that what happened in Crimea is just unbearable. What is the most unbearable for me is the right which some states, countries, diplomats take to decide what is the fate of peoples. The Crimea belongs to Russian space. Ukraine should be a bridge between the West and Russia. The destiny of Ukraine is certainly not to join Europe, because it would be provocative against Russia. But come on, this is absolutely the following of the Brezhnev Doctrine. This is an insult to the spirit, the will of the real peoples. And this is what French writer Marcel Proust called les chancelleries d'état-major, which is absolutely disgusting. And old century. This is the diplomacy of 19th century. So I am shocked by that. I think that the comparison with the Brezhnev Doctrine is completely right. I must say that in my country, there is too many people who take for granted the Putin doctrine that Russia is at home wherever Russian language is spoken. It is not the position of the government of France, thanks God. Hollande has a very strong and brave position, but a lot of people, including the former president, accept to endorse this idea, which if it was taken seriously, if it was implemented, if it was universalized, it would mean the collapse of Europe, because I don't think that there is one country in Europe which would survive if we made a law of this idea of the language you speak is the key of the country to which you belong. But there is a lot of people who buy this theory in Europe. The idea that Crimea belongs to Russia because it was given by Brezhnev, this theory.
Khrushchev.
Yeah, by Khrushchev, I'm sorry, by Khrushchev in 1954 or 57.
54.
This idea is taken for granted again by so many opinion makers in Europe. But again, this way of redesigning borders, according to so-called history, is the Pandora box of the explosion of Europe.
Mr. Helgesen, Russia asked that the Helsinki Declaration of 1975 should be made valid for the post-communist borders within the Soviet Union. By invading the Crimea, has Putin violated the Helsinki Declaration of 1975?
Yes, clearly. This is a breach of the entire European security system as it existed during the Cold War and as it's been further built after the fall of the Berlin Wall. And that is why I very much agree that we need to stand up against those who are apologetic against this or about this kind of behavior. And I think we also need to be mindful that this conflict is not only materialized through annexation of Crimea, through military aggression in eastern Ukraine, but it's also taking place through hybrid warfare in the rest of Ukraine and in Europe. There is, if you look at which political parties in the European Parliament that voted against the association agreement for Ukraine, Moldova and Georgia, these are also political parties that to a large extent have expressed sympathy with Mr. Putin's
policies. But in the Georgian matter, according to the European Union, it was the Georgians who opened fire in August 2008. But I will stay one more minute with the internal motives of Putin. There is murdered a person in Russia 40 times more often than in the whole EU area. They have had a demographic loss of 10 million men in the 1990s. 25% of the Russians are living beneath the level of minimum of existence. Did Putin need an exterior enemy? And did he read his Goebbels before he took to Ukraine last year?
I think this is a question that lends itself to disciplines beyond politics and beyond law, which is my
discipline. But it is a part of history.
Certainly a part of history, but I don't think we, in terms of responding to the situation, we don't need to interpret motives. We can see what has been expressed, and we can clearly see that there are some assumptions underlying Russia's behavior that are not the assumptions and the principles that we would like to build Europe on if we want Europe to remain free and secure and prosperous.
Mr. Levy, the last 5 years, Putin's mass medias have been advocating the view that Europe, Western Europe, is going into self-liquidation. because we are too lenient versus immigrants. You came from Iraq yesterday. May Mr. Putin have a point?
Mr. Putin has a wish, not a point. The wish of Mr. Putin is to see Europe weakened, even more, collapsing, for different reasons, for two reasons. First one, I recalled this famous or infamous quote of Putin saying that the biggest disaster was the collapse of Soviet Union. In the Putin view, as far as I know, there are some responsible of this collapse. America, but America is really strong and far away to be retaliated. There is a Pope, John Paul II, which is held in the narrative of Russia to have a huge responsibility of that, and Europe in general. The Putin narrative stresses that on and on, that Europe has a responsibility in this collapse. So there is a will of revenge. This will of revenge takes many forms. For example, the support given by the Kremlin to all the forces in Europe who fight against the European project, which is extreme right. On ground, earth, roots, infinity of the earth, to the liquidity of the maritime, of the sea empires, the feminization of the European societies, and so on. And Putin endorses this theory. So there is, in the spirit of Putin, why not, a clash between two visions of the world. He believes that human rights is a stupidity which is only aimed at weakening the strength and the virility of the true peoples and so on. So there is this. It is not only a matter of power, it's a matter of ideas. The fact that Putin has this point is his problem. But we should understand that and oppose our own values to his. This is a real problem. Not to be willing, not to be able to oppose our own body of values, which are embodied by Ukrainians, to the body of values of the new Russia of Putin.
Mr. Helgesen, Monsieur Levy started by correcting my question. He said Putin has a wish to weakening Europe. Is that why Mr. Putin is shoving Afghans through the border of Norway in the far north? And what will you do about it?
Again, I will not lend myself to speculation about motives.
But you must have an opinion, sir. I'd like to have an embassy in Moscow.
I'd like to stress that I agree very much with the fact that the ideas and the practices coming out of the Russian government and Mr. Putin are ideas and practices that Europe must be very clear in rejecting, opposing, and reacting against. We also need to see that Putin's policies in Ukraine don't exactly make up good strategy. He has succeeded in uniting the Ukrainian people around a national cause in a way that is rather remarkable. I'm not sure that's what he set out to do, but he has achieved that. I think he, to the extent he wants to weaken Europe, that is also bad strategy for Russia. Russia is not served by, strategically by...
Now you are Europe. Embarking upon Putin's motives by telling us what is good for Russia. Why don't you answer what is bad for Russia?
I think also that it's good for Europe, strategically, to have a good relationship with Russia, which is why we need to try to keep all possible channels for communication open, while ensuring that we don't keep channels of communications open that would amount to appeasement, to use Mr. Levy's words. This is a difficult situation for Europe. Russia is permanent. Russia is there. It's our neighbor. Europe has other considerations here than the Americans, for example. They have an ocean between themselves. But we need to combine a very strong, united European response on the basis of our principles and values with the strategic eye to the long term. And I think they go together.
Maybe not all of you have quite present the history of the Crimea. So let me just briefly, because it has an impact today. It was Tsar Alexei, Peter the Great's father, who gave protection to Bogdan Khmelnytsky, the leader of the Ukrainian Cossacks in the middle of the 17th century. It cost Ukraine sovereignty for 350 years. Nikita Khrushchev gave away the Crimea from the Russian Republic of the Soviet Union to the Ukraine in 54. And then when the Soviet Union is dissolved on the 8th of December 1991, Ukraine had a new president, Leonid Kravchuk. Last year he said, this afternoon in 1991, he just waited for Russia's president, Boris Yeltsin, to say that when we divorce after 350 years, we Russians want to take Ukraine with us. And had Yeltsin said so, according to Kravchuk, he would have said, Конечно. Yes, naturally. But then Yeltsin got tips in the afternoon and forgot to hold Crimea. So we mustn't underestimate the personal factor of international politics. However, do you see peaceful, acceptable ways that the Russians, who constitute 70% of the Crimean population, could have reunited with Russia without that bullshit that Putin has organized? Referendum?
Do I see what? I did not get the question, I'm sorry.
Could the Russians in the Crimea, mm-hmm. reunited without an invasion, without annexation?
They would not have...
Through, for instance, a referendum.
It was no question of referendum. There was no...
It wasn't, but it could have been.
It could have been after Putin having ignited the situation. After Putin or the Russian TV channels having burning the brains of the Crimean people, the question was not raised in Crimea for years and years. So of course, in any country, I could imagine, even in this country or in my country, a secessionist movement through channels of propaganda, telling the people that they are victims of history, etc. It's so easy to do. The question was not raised. And we cannot accept that. If the Crimea coup, because it was a coup, endorsed by a fake referendum, if it was accepted, I believe that the whole architecture. I agree that we have to dialogue with Putin. I agree that Russia is not only here, it is a great people. It is a huge culture. It is one of the best literature in the world. All this is clear. But are we going to leave the architecture of security of our continent to be broken by a precedent which could be followed by others? I'm sure you noticed, Mr. Minister, that recently, a few weeks ago, the same Putin said like this in a discussion with journalists that it would take for the Russian army less than 2 days to reach Warsaw. It was reported in the Süddeutsche Zeitung in Germany. You probably noticed that in last July, there was five months ago, there was a commission of the Duma who was appointed in order to re-examine the legality of the independence of the Baltic states. What does that mean? All that means that Crimea could be, if we don't oppose to that, a very strong statement position could be a precedent for a remolding of Europe in the interest maybe of Russia, but certainly not of the peoples composing Europe.
Do you think that the Crimea became a method more than a goal, since NATO does not accept member states with a territorial conflict with another neighbor state?
Well, I think what we've seen is that Europeanization of Ukraine has been given sufficient reason for fear, but it has produced fear in Moscow about their neighborhood, and that's why these actions have been taken. I think we fully agree that we need to stand up to the kind of behavior we've seen, the violation of international law, and I think that's why the military reassurance measures in the Baltic states, for example, is very important. That's why I think beefing up militaries across Europe will be very important. We're not of the view that we should step up military engagement in Ukraine. There's been some discussion about that, but that's not our view. But I think demonstrating that NATO is capable of defending its member states and that we're responding to aggression in our neighborhood and a more dangerous Europe by beefing up military capacities is also very important. I'd like also just to say one thing about your question on whether Crimea could have found other ways to become part of Russia. Any country has strategic interests, and great powers have big strategic interests. And prior to the occupation of Crimea, it was evident that Russia had significant strategic interests in Crimea. They had a naval base there, they had a security interest in the Black Sea region. But the way of dealing with and securing one's security or strategic interests is not to behave in the way Russia behaved. And that's where we need to draw the line. You can accept strategic interest, you could accept that there should have been a dialogue between the Ukrainian government and Russia about the base, etc., etc., but we just need to flatly reject the change of borders by violence.
Your own party member, former Prime Minister Korvilok, advocates the view that we must understand Mr. Putin, and he does actively emphasize the Russia's sphere of influence. Is that appeasement policy?
I don't want to label.
Why don't we label? Because a label, sir, that is a diagnosis.
But I'd like to say that I disagree with the notion, or I disagree with, how should I put it, the indication that we should accept spheres of influence in Europe. We should accept that Ukraine is a sovereign state, and that the Ukrainian people have a sovereign right to determine their course and their destiny. And that's what they did at Maidan, and that's why we need to support that.
Mr. Levy, in my wife's homeland, Hungary, there was a very popular proverb that to teach Russian in Budapest would be as teaching barking in a cat's farm. Can you understand the view?
And there was also big demonstrations in the streets of people, like your maybe the relatives of your wife, saying, with scanning, shouting, we don't want to be a colony of Russia again. This was what was said a few weeks ago in Budapest. So that is a stake.
But if the West does not stand up for the Ukraine, are we losing credibility as carriers of liberal values?
If we don't stand, if the West does not stand for Ukraine, we might see Hungary, we might see a dirty deal between Mr. Orban and Mr. Putin. We might see another dirty deal between Mr. Tsipras and Mr. Putin. We know this is not it is not leaks of information, it's documented information that Tsipras visited Putin twice when he was negotiating with Europe, asked Putin some money to reprint new drachma and so on. So we could see that. We could see the Russian army. He said it, Sudeisho Zeitung, within 2 days in Warsaw. For what? For doing tourism? I don't think so. We could see the Baltic countries having their independence put again on the table. This is a very serious matter. Frankly, I saw enough wars in my life to be really more devoted than anyone to peace. Number one. Number two, one of the big achievements of European Union has been to put the ghost of war out of our landscape, out of our brains. I'm very afraid today to see the ghost of war coming back. I'm very afraid to see peoples who paid such a high price for their freedom, Poland, Hungary,
Czechoslovakia,
go back in the backyard, in the bad yard. I'm very afraid of that. And I really believe that, of course, we have to discuss with Putin. We have to have all the channels of discussion open, but only if, at the same time, we are able to have a firm stand against what is not acceptable for our peoples.
I agree, and I think Europe and the EU should not only stand up to Putin and preach our values to Putin, the EU should also practice its values within the EU. And that's why the Norwegian government has been clear that the EU should have responded in more robust ways against Hungary, like Norway, in all modesty, has done by stopping the Norwegian grants to Hungary because of Hungary's violation of the basis for them and the harassment of NGOs. Last year, Mr. Putin paid an official visit to Budapest. One of the things he did there, which wasn't widely reported, was to lay the wreath at a monument celebrating the fight against the counter-revolutionary forces of 1956. Mm-hmm. That Prime Minister Orban could let President Putin do such a thing. And this happens within the European Union. I just find
Would you prefer to qualify Mr. Orban's behavior somewhat more specific?
How would you label it?
We all know the oldest profession in this world, don't we? I just make a suggestion.
I have actually used quite strong words about Mr. Orban and his policies, and I think you can read them in the Financial Times.
This was just pulling your leg. Let's return into the Ukraine, which is in a horrendous state of affairs. There is a popular joke about the three exits of the Ukrainian crisis. The probable one is that God himself takes it into his hands. The improbable one is that the West will help. And the unthinkable one is that the Ukrainians will help themselves. What do you think about it?
I think that the Ukrainians are already helping themselves. frankly, I go often to Ukraine, to the west of Ukraine, to the east of Ukraine. I was in the Oblast of Donetsk, just bombed by a huge rocket. This night, a single bomb had made 68 or 78 deaths. So I am so impressed by the bravery, by the dignity of these people, by the way in they chose Europe. This choice, they believe that it would be an easy choice, that it would be a road of roses for various reasons. Some depending, unfortunately, on the half shake hands we gave. The path reveals to be much more difficult, but they stand firmly on their choice. They don't regret it one second. They wage this war, and they might win it. I saw in Kramatorsk the commanders of the army of Poroshenko. So brave, old man, our age sometimes. Seriously.
The man with a future behind.
The man with a future behind, the man who never thought they would have to make a war, men who hate war and who do it nevertheless, and who do it so bravely. I saw the people of Debaltseve after their evacuation a few days before the anniversary of Maidan, vilified by the Russian narrative, but they acted really as great guys, as heroes. So Ukraine is already helping itself, accepting some sacrifices, accepting reforms. Is, as I said this morning, is very rare in a country at war who has to wage and to win a war to do at the same times the heavy reforms which have to be done, which are very profitable on long term, but always cost a lot on short term. Ukrainian people again accept that silently with a lot of courage. So the hypothesis most probable is the third one. Unfortunately for God and for Europe.
Mr. Helgesen, your government has ample and good relations with President Petro Poroshenko. Is he a modern man? Is he a modern man? Not all men in the Ukraine are, or Russia.
At least he's trying to cope with modernity. And it's a balancing act for any Ukrainian politician these days. But I think it's quite impressive what the Ukrainians have been able to achieve. This year they have a negative economic growth of, I think, minus 12%. Next year they're looking at 2% positive growth. They're turning the corner economically. They're attracting more investment. And I think the strongest signal that Ukraine could give to Russia is to emerge economically successful, because that would give a basis for continued popular support for the political choices made and for the population to see that Europeanization and integration pays off. It's very important that from the side of Europe we continue to support through aid, but not least by investment and trade. That's why a conference like the one by the Chamber of Commerce today is important. But it's also critical that Ukraine continues its reform agenda. The reform agenda is there through the association agreement with the European Union. Fighting corruption, not least in the judiciary, judicial reform, is absolutely essential to be successful in attracting investment and sustain high levels of investment going forward.
Yet, Mr. Levy, in Moscow and in all over Russia, mass media label Kiev as a fascist regime. Is that merely an example that it hurts to be angry when no one is scared?
There is less fascist in Kiev than in Moscow. There is less extreme right in Kiev, unfortunately, than in Paris. True. If you compare the electoral score of private sector and all the extreme right in Ukraine to the score of National Front in France, I'm sorry, but there is no comparison. If you look at the Maidan, I was in the Maidan various times, at the hottest times, as you were, Maidan was a place where all words were permitted. It was the sanctuary of free speech, as all revolutionary situations. Everything could be said by anyone. There was a stage which was taken by anyone wanted, even me. Every fantasy could be expressed. There is one delirium, one fantasy which was never expressed. No, one graffiti which was never written on the walls, which is anti-Semitic opinions. This is very impressive. In this country, who has an anti-Semitic past, who is the country of Holodomor, of course, but also of Babi Yar, which is the country of the Shoah by bullets, who has a big, bad, terrible track record on these regards. This never came back, not once, on this temple of free speech, which was Maidan. So there is a lot of explanation to that. I'm not going today to enter in theory, except if you are interested, but it is a fact that the Ukrainian people has begun and partly achieved a great work on its own dark memory, on the dark side of its weakness. The work has begun much more, unfortunately, than in Russia, because I love Russia. I devoted half of my life to encourage, let's say, human rights and freedom in Russia. But the work is done in Ukraine much more than in Russia. And I was another example. A few weeks ago, there is every year, I attended an event, very impressive, in a city 2 hours from Kiev, which is Uman. Uman is a city in the countryside of Ukraine, which is the birthplace of one of the biggest, most important thinkers of Judaism, Rabbi Nachman of Breslov, who is the master thinker of the Hasidim. Every year, the city is invaded by very strange tourists who are Hasidic Jews coming from all over the world and spending 1 week just before Rosh Hashanah there. And I can tell you that tens of thousands of Hasidic Jews arriving in a city, believe me, it's a big, great joy, a great event, but a big mess. What impressed me, frankly, was the kindness, the hospitality of the people of Uman. It was a debonair event. I was there during the 3 days. I wanted to see that because for me it was one of the keystone. If the 180,000 Hasidic Jews could come in Uman for 1 week to put their tents, to make their own food, to dance all the night, to make music, to drink a lot of alcohol with a joyful atmosphere and with the people of Ukraine welcoming them, something would be changed in the kingdom of Ukraine. It is the fact.
Take a breath.
Never!
Because I will tell you a story very briefly. During the Orange Revolution, I interviewed the chief rabbi of the Crystal Synagogue in Podolia in Kiev, who had been beaten severely up with thugs. In front of his two small daughters. He was a young man, and he said, here in the Ukraine, we love conspiration theories. And the most popular one is the Jewish one. That's why they grasped to that first. Do you really mean that anti-Semitism has vanished from the Ukraine?
No. It has not. It never vanishes from anywhere. So the question is not to vanish. The question is to... Anti-Semitism is like, is a virus. A virus can be active or can be deactivated. I would say that it is very active in Russia, that it is again active in my own and dear and cherished country, France, and I think that it is often deactivated in Ukraine. It is a fact. The fact that there was no one slogan anti-Semitic in the Maidan, no one graffiti, and believe me,
If you looked at the House of Syndicate, all of the House on Maidan, every stupidity could be written on the wall and was written, except this one. This is called, I call it, a deactivated virus.
Having spent 20 years in Moscow myself, I will support you on one point. In 1998, Boris Yeltsin's Minister of Information labeled the Russian Jews as parasites who should be deported. Let me return to the Ukraine. It took 8 Norwegian oil funds to restore East Germany, Mr. Helgesen. What will the cost be for the Ukraine? Exactly.
The biggest cost would be for Ukraine to fail.
And can Europe help at all?
Europe can help. Norway has a tendency to think very much in terms of aid. I think we have we always accuse the Americans that because they have a big hammer, they see every problem as a nail. To some extent, because we have a big aid budget, we see every problem as something that we can solve with aid. And we are stepping up aid to Ukraine, and I think that's important, but that's only a part of the picture. I think trade and investment, economic vibrancy, is really what matters.
But my good thinker.
It matters to security and it matters to politics.
But my good thinker. In November 2013, Ukraine came to the summit in Vilnius with an indebtedness of 30 billion American dollars to Russia because of gas, and the EU offered 800 million euros. Wasn't that an offer at the level beneath the ass of a frog?
Maybe, and the Ukrainians did not change their point of view, did not change their wish and their hope, and this again is rather admirable. What I just want
to add...
You should
never ask a French about the frog, by the way.
What I just want to add is that I don't know how it would cost, but I'm not an economist, but I know it would cost less than to the plan which has been implemented, which has half succeeded and which still might fail to save Greece. To bring Ukraine to the level of Poland today or East Germany would cost less than to save the Greek banks, which are still at the edge of collapse.
I think Europe needs to step up, and at this moment, when Europe is challenged in so many or from so many directions, we must not lose sight of the big test for Europe that is in Ukraine. There's a risk now that attention is going elsewhere, or it is elsewhere, but we need to stick to our commitment to Ukraine. But the flip side of the EU and West European commitment is the work that needs to be done by the Ukrainians themselves in terms of reforming their public administration, reforming their economy, fighting corruption, and not least, as I said, reforming the judiciary, because that's the basis for sustainable growth in Ukraine.
You mentioned a very important thing after this EU summit with the Ukraine. They didn't change their mind. And of course, it was the youth of the Ukraine seeing possibilities to study in the Schengen area, work there, evaporating. Even polls in Russia show that the gross bulk of Russians younger than 24 years old only dream about a possibility where they could have been born and raised in a liberal West European society. Fine, we know people want to come to Europe, for God's sake, but can we receive the Ukrainian youth in a meaningful way when we have a tsunami of refugees from the Middle East and Africa to handle? Or are they too late, both of you? Maybe you start, Mr. Helgesen.
Well, clearly many European countries, not least the Central and Eastern European countries, are facing a demographic challenge, and they need a qualified workforce, and many Ukrainians have qualifications. Now, obviously, they need first and foremost to be put to work for rebuilding Ukraine and make a prosperous Ukraine. But I believe a vital part of the European integration is the freedom of movement. And therefore, a part of the process with Ukraine must also be to stimulate educational exchanges, maybe incorporate them into the Erasmus program, et cetera, to really build an integration that is not only at the level of politicians, not only at the level of public institutions, but also at the level of people.
Russian youth, they say, we've been around Europe with mommy and daddy and grandpa and grandma. We have seen another world. Much the same picture is valid in the Ukraine. Will anyone stay at home? And they speak English.
Two things. Number one, I don't think that the dream of Ukrainians is to become taxi driver in Europe, in Paris or in Oslo. Their dream is to be helped by Europe, to be to see investors coming to their country, and to build their country with their own hands. They are patriotic. They love their country. They are linked to it. The dream is not to leave Ukraine, is not to come and invade Western Europe, number one. And by the way, they believe that they are the core of Europe. They don't feel themselves as the border of Europe. They feel spiritually, intellectually as the core. So why would they leave Ukraine? Number two, you said something very important. It is true that a lot, you said a lot of important things, but this one especially. It is exact that a lot of young Russians dream of Europe. This is a nightmare of Mr. Putin. Because at the end of the day, let's imagine 1 minute that Europe helps really Ukraine, that Ukraine becomes Poland. And let's imagine that in 5 years, the poor people of Crimea, who have been completely misled by their leadership and Russia, discover the misery in which they are, and they compare. Within 5 years, a new Poland, which is Ukraine, and a new Siberia, which is, I exaggerate, which is Crimea. Nightmare for Putin. And not only Crimea, but the people in Russia who say, but finally, it was a better deal to deal with Mr. Norway, with Mr. France, than to deal with Mr. Putin. This is one of the concerns of Putin, not the ideology, but also the fear that the example of a country helped by Europe could be a plague for his own people.
But Mr. Helgesen, both the Russian-speaking and the Ukrainian-speaking elites of the Ukraine are corrupt. What specific demands must they be met with? Because we saw the parliamentary elections last year. That was a huge no to the old regime and also a huge no to corruption. How blunt are you with them when you talk with them?
We are blunt. I believe the European Union is blunt. And the number one priority is to combat corruption in the judiciary. And that's the number one priority when it comes to demands from our side. It's probably the number one difficulty for the Ukrainian power holders. One of them told me last year in discretion that our judiciary is independent, and so it is independently corrupt.
Mr. Levy, we have a very famous poet here in Norway, Arnulf Øverland. He once said that the uniform is the idiot's chance to become God. Is this the reason for why neither the Ukraine nor Russia is able to build and expand a civil society?
To build an?
A civil society.
Maybe
militarism. In other words,
No. I understood. Maybe Russia is prevented by militarism to build to fulfill the promise of the Yeltsin years, because there was this will of a civil society. But in Ukraine, it is not true. Those who are under the uniform, whom I quoted before, who are our age, They are unwilling uniformed people. They are unwilling soldiers. They hate the war they are compelled to do. And I think that one of the most vibrant civil society I saw in Europe since long is the civil society in Ukraine. Maidan was an ununiformed gathering, and again, so vibrant. About corruption, of course, it is the number one problem. But my feeling is that it is, for the first time, taken at the very flesh of it. Ukraine has the chance to have a president, Mr. Poroshenko, maybe because he is already rich, maybe because he is virtuous, because he is a good man.
And he is the chocolate king.
Maybe because he is already the chocolate king, yes. But maybe also because he is a good man. I happen to know him a little. He has made his priority of this fight against corruption. And this is not an easy task in such a country where the corruption is so widespread. But he does it. And this will be one of the merits of Poroshenko when he leaves office in 3 years, I hope in 8 years. It will be one of his merits. And the task, the Minister of Economy, Mrs. Valérie Ionescu is also grasping the question. No, Ukraine is on the good road, obviously. She only needs a real help from us.
Mr. Poroshenko told me last year, the Russians know me, and they do. Still, they do not have a convincing dialogue, and the Minsk II process is not very fruitful. What does that tell us about the conflict, Mr. Helgesen?
Well, first of all, if the Russians know Mr. Poroshenko, he also knows them, which probably bodes for some realism in the relationship. Minsk II is not perfect, but it is what we have. We've seen now for a while relative calm in eastern Ukraine, but over the last few days, we've seen that change again, unclear for how long. But it does point to the situation as not one that is easy to fix when it comes to Russia's aggression and Russia's behavior. I think what we've seen in the last calm period is that there is no doubt that Russia is able to pull the strings and command the situation in eastern Ukraine. That's been demonstrated through that period. Now the question is, or I think not regardless of, but while there is the instability in eastern Ukraine, the rest of Ukraine needs to make progress on reform and needs to show economic success. Ultimately, that's the biggest and strongest message for Mr. Putin.
I stopped counting corpses on Thursday, the 20th February last year in Kiev, when I had counted 50 men shot and killed in front of my TV camera. What more was killed in the bilateral relationship between the two largest Slavonic states that day?
The trust, the confidence, part of the belief in a common future, which will have to be restored, because even if, as the Ukrainian people hopes, and as I hope for him, even if Ukraine joins the European club, Ukraine will have to keep relationship with Russia. But this possibility, part of it, is dead this day on the Maidan, when the number passed the 50 and reached the 100, the celeste century, the century as something was for a long time broken in the living together of the two peoples, for sure. And they are on the other side, so close, because you said Ukrainian speakers and the Russian speakers. This is so mixed. So many Ukrainian patriots are Russian speakers. So many Ukrainian of the West speak Russian, and Ukrainian of the East speak Ukrainian, opposite to what is said too often in the media. All the two cultures are so deeply mixed. I had an experience myself. I performed a theatrical text which I wrote 1 year ago in Odessa, in Kiev, and in Lviv. The only city where I was compelled, where I was deeply, strongly asked, because I was acting in French, and there was subtitles, electronic subtitles in Ukrainian, above my head, you know, electronic subtitles defining. I did that in Odessa. I did that in Kiev. When it came to do it in Lviv, I was strongly asked by the mayor of Lviv, by the people organizer, to have also subtitles in Russian.
Speaking about Lemberg, founded by the Austro-Hungarian dual monarchy now.
Yes, I know. It is the city of porcelain. It is just to tell you how Russian and Ukrainian identities are mingled, are mixed in this country. So it is a crime against, it is also a crime against spirit to have broken in part, I hope not definitely, this link of life between the two countries and the two spirits.
Well, Fyodor Dostoevsky taught us that brethren are not necessarily very good friends in the Karamazov novel. It is an odyssey of hatred. So returning to the more earthly things, are the sanctions against Russia effective, Mr. Helgesen?
I think they have an effect.
Big or small?
That is difficult to say because they have been imposed at the same time that you've seen the steep decline in the oil price, which has, as we know, an effect on oil exporting countries.
Well, the stabilization fund was cut in half the last 13 months and will be cut in another half the next 12 months, according to Russia's government. Does that say something about financial pressure on Putin?
I think there is financial pressure. I don't think it's acute, but it is accumulating. And I think as a result of the financial pressure and as a result of political priorities, meaning beefing up the military, cutting social services, there might also be social pressures.
Mr. Levy, Russia stopped all food imports from the European Union. That means 50% of all consumed food in Russia. Then they said in September last year, we are going to boost productivity in agriculture with 65%. In September, the Moscow papers wrote, only 1/3 of arable land is cultivated. What is your philosophical advice to Mr. Putin's peasants?
To forget Stalin, to forget Stakhanov, to forget Lysenko, to forget all these wishful, how do you say that? You know, to believe that the belief that to state things is enough to create them. This is the old Stalinistic way of thinking, and it's completely crazy.
I would like to put a specific question here. The mere fact that both the Ukrainians and the Russians were victims of Stalinism, shouldn't that be a platform for kind of reuniting them?
Of course, of course. It should be. It has been. In the beginning of the 90s, there was this feeling of brotherhood between the two peoples going out of the under the boot. There was this this solidarity of the shaken, as the Czech philosopher Jan Patočka says, between all the peoples of the area, including the Russians. A man like Boris Nemtsov, a man like Mikhail Khodorkovsky, feel themselves close by the heart and close by the spirit to the Ukrainian people. No doubt on that. This solidarity exists, but when you have a country which is submitted to a rolling fire of propaganda all over the day, when this propaganda tells you that there is a world conspiracy against the Russian people, where this propaganda tells you that it is a gay plot or a Jewish plot or a Freemasonry plot which is trying to humiliate Russia, when you have this propaganda telling you that you are an empire but a besieged empire, interesting concept of Mr. Putin, this part of the people may lose its nerves and lose part of his capacity to reason. This is called despotism, and Russia is under the weight of a despot. That is the case.
Is it the despotism, or is it merely police state lights?
We might enter into the differences, but the result is that the press is not free. The result is that the main opponent to the regime of Putin is assassinated at a few meters from the Kremlin. The result is that in a country where the secret police is so powerful, the guilty people of this murder have not been found mysteriously as the murderers of Anna Politkovskaya, and so on. The result is the same. Russia, and I say that with broken heart, because again, it is not a way of speaking. I spent half of my public life to try to, with my little means, to help these people fighting for his liberty. I remember the time of the dissidents. I remember this meeting in Helsinki. It's so sad to see this culture of freedom, spirit of liberty, who was supposed to be even a new blood and a new fresh air for us, Europe, to be frozen by Putinism. So we can call it authoritarianism, despotism, totalitarianism. This is labeling, but it's not the deep of the problem.
Mr. Helgesen, our main objective versus the Soviet Union was the Iron Curtain, absence of freedom to travel, absence of freedom of talk. Today, basically, it's the federal TV channels in Russia, which is censored. Most of the other medias are free. Is it fair to call it a despotic system?
You're so keen on labels.
I beg your pardon?
You're so keen on labels.
I'm very keen on explanations, but you have to call a spade, and a whore, a whore. It's you evading answers specifically. Do you, for instance, see preconditions for change in the regime inside the Kremlin?
I think no regime is immune to change. Russia is a country, it's a great country, rich traditions. We have a rich history of being neighbors as well. Russia has proven its ability to change in the past, and I believe it is under some pressures now. It's shredding some 1 million people from its work force every year. The demographics are not looking good. There are fundamental issues in the economy that need addressing, and they're not being addressed in the ways things are run now. So I will never lose hope in change. But when it comes to labels, this man wrote a very interesting book once called Barbarism with a Human Face. Still an interesting read. At least that was the Norwegian title. I don't know about the French title.
Mr. Levy, Nikita Khrushchev was unseated because of sable rattling, the Cuban crisis. The Soviet Union fell apart, basically because people were so fatigued, tired, after decades of inadequate food deliveries. Can these factors together lead to a regime change inside the Kremlin today?
As Mr. Ministro said, no regime is immune to change.
That is banal.
Wait a minute, especially Russia. I remember when I was a young man, when I wrote Barbarism with a Human Face, no one could expect could expect in his living time to see this great empire collapse. And frankly, I met in the 70s, in the 80s, I was friends with a lot of people throughout Europe who were fighting the Soviet Union. I never heard one of them say, predicting that in a normal range of time, this regime will disappear. It did disappear. This is not a banality. It is an absolute miracle of history, number one. Number two, my belief is that Russia today is weak, that Putin is weak. He acts as a strong man, he plays Popeye, he shows his nude torso fishing and riding horse and so on. All this is cosmetic, it's my belief, in order to hide his fundamental weakness. Weakness in terms of demography, in terms of corruption, because Ukraine is corrupted, but what about Russia? And corruption is a source of poverty, is a source of economical decline, as everyone knows. He is weak because the confidence, the trust of his people is more fragile than we believe. After the death of Nemtsov, there was a huge demonstration, bigger than we could expect in the street of Russia. So, of course, everything could happen. And again, this perspective, this knowledge of his own weakness, this perspective of a possible new nightmare, which is new collapse, might be one of the key and one of the explanation of the provocations and the race ahead of Putin today in Ukraine.
How long will the new Cold War last, Mr. Helgesen? The European Union is the biggest, the largest trade partner for Russia. I've been 10 times around Norway the last 12 months, and the Norwegian business community is asking, how long will this last? Because Norway, per capita, is paying the biggest price of these sanctions than any other state, either within or outside the European Union. How long will it last? It's not a label, it is an estimate.
It will last as long as Mr. Putin uphold his policies and practices vis-a-vis Ukraine. We are determined to stay the course on these responses because we believe that this is fundamentally about international law and fundamental freedoms in Europe, and they are needed in Ukraine, but they're also needed in Norway and other European countries, and we need to demonstrate the resolve mm-hmm. to uphold those values.
By the values.
Absolutely, because we have maybe the 25 first years after the end of the Cold War, we thought that we had reached the end of history. We cherished our liberal, nice values, but we didn't focus a lot of attention on the more muscular policies to defend those values. And I think now we're in a new situation. We need to be hard-nosed about defending those values. And the sanctions are about that.
Mr. Levy, we started with the Cold War and we will end with it. Because the cooling down period between East and West after the five big peaks of the Cold War was between 4 and 8 years. Now the world goes faster today. How long time do you think we will endure this crisis before it kind of is liquidated or Putin falls or we agree with him?
It depends on that. It depends on Putin. Not necessarily his fall. His fall would be, of course, the most, or his exit from power would be the most easy solution, if he does not stay as he did with Medvedev, by the way.
Poor man.
No, but there is another solution, which is Putin understanding what is happening. Again, people say that he is crazy, that he is autistic. and so on. I don't know him, of course. I know Poroshenko, but I don't have the chance to know Mr. Putin. And as I am blacklisted in Russia, I am on the blacklist. It has no chance to change in the near future. But what I guess, what I feel, is that he is a reasonable man. If he understands that the game is finished, if he understands that he will find in front of him a strong Norway, a strong France, a stronger European Union, if he understands that his oligarchs will impoverish themselves, will become poorer and poorer, that his own fortune, which is estimated, I don't know what, I don't know how many zeros, is going to get flat, then my strong belief is that the world having changed, the game could be over before we expect.
Putin once said that we have a tradition to find a good common language with the French leadership. Is President Hollande a tougher opponent for Putin than was Sarkozy?
For sure. He's more tough. It's not a question of toughness, but Sarkozy, it is a fact. Sarkozy was a good president on some other aspects, but Sarkozy belongs to those in France who want to understand Putin at any cost, and who even was quoted once as saying that he understands the argument of the linguistic nationalism. Hollande is not in this case. Hollande is really strong. There was one test for Hollande, big test for a man of state, which was the delivery of the warships which were promised by Sarkozy and which were fully built under Hollande. Hollande had to deliver that to Putin. It was between Minsk 1 and Minsk 2, at the middle of the arm wrestling with Putin. He should have delivered. There was a contract. Huge amount of money, billions or 1 billion, I don't know. He decided not to deliver. He was very strongly attacked for that by all the French right, and not speaking of the extreme right, that he was dishonoring France, that nobody would trust in the future the signature of his country, and so on. He stood firm. He did not deliver the boats. Putin was so surprised. It was such a break with the old Gaullist tradition. General de Gaulle, who did a lot of good things, but not with Soviet Union. So Putin has, in the person of Mrs. Merkel, in the person of your prime minister, in the person of François Hollande, real strong, not adversaries, because they are not adversaries, but strong statesmen and women who seem to be decided to stop the Russian imperialism. We finished with the history of colonialism in Europe. Our generation refused, demonstrated in the street against American imperialism, and we were right. It is not to accept today the imperialism of Mr. Putin.
Yet, Mr. Helgesen, and this is my final question. Russia's economy is the same as Italy's. It's 14 times smaller than the economies of the EU, the United States, and countries like Norway. In Russia, there are basically living 140 million people. The opposing side has a population of 952 million people. Can Putin win this fight?
I don't think so. I think he has already lost the hearts and minds of the Ukrainian people. I think with continued determination to stand up for shared European and universal values on the part of the EU and the Transatlantic Alliance, and the willingness to not only talk values, but act in defense of values, I think we will be able to see a Ukraine that can pursue the choice that the Ukrainian people has
Must
made.
Must we take a tougher stand versus those who want to understand Putin in the Western world.
I think what we need to do is not to understand or not understand Putin. We need to understand Russia, and we need to respect that Russia is a great country that we want to have a constructive, good partnership with. That is not the situation today, because good partners don't act in the way that the current Russian administration acts. But our strategic interest as a neighboring country, but also Europe's strategic interest, is to see a Europe whole and free, and to hopefully see the boundaries of freedom expanded. Ukraine is now very much the test case for the continued success of the European integration process, which is a freedom project, and I fundamentally believe it will be successful.
Wisely spoken, sir. In conclusion, I haven't the text in English, but I have translated Russia's most famous Forstanden fatter Russland ei. Og tenke i vanlige mål og nei, der et eget land må vite, på Russland må vi bare lite. Takk for oppmerksomheten.